Good morning, everyone. I think it's 10 o'clock, so we're going to get started. So I am Bobby Jean Schweitzer. I'm the chair of this session, and we're going to talk about cardiac evaluation. I wanted to introduce my fellow presenters here. So we can't see the slides from here. Can I? Oh, yeah, there it is. Okay, now it's up. Great. So first off, I'm a professor of medical education at University of Virginia near Washington, D.C., out of the United States. And I'm presenting on the North American perspective for risk assessment. And my co-presenters are Dr. Pedro Ibarra from Columbia, Bogota, Colombia. And I just learned that he did a fellowship in critical care at NYU. And then he did a master's in the UK, I believe. And he's going to present on the international perspective on risk assessment approaches. So it'll be interesting to see the overlap there. And then lastly, but not least, is Dr. Soichi Uezono, who's from Tokyo. And he's a pediatric anesthesiologist. And I also just learned that he was at Boston Children's and did his training there. And overlapped just a little bit of time that I had spent in Boston. So it's a really small world. We all have converged here and met for the first time in Singapore. And I'm sure many of you have come a very long way. So welcome, and we're delighted to have you with us. Do you want to put up my first slides? Is that possible? Oh, I control it? Awesome. Okay. So our overall, this panel, we're going to talk about cardiac risk assessment before non-cardiac surgery. And again, there is our contact information and our titles. I think my first slide as well has contact information on it. So if you want to take a photograph of this and you want to email me or contact me later, I would be delighted to engage. I'm also happy to always share my slides. I think I've tried to put references on each of my slides, but I'm also happy to send you the PDFs of the articles, because I know sometimes when you are out in other countries, it's more challenging to download some of the articles. And I'd be delighted to have you email me and contact me, and I'll send those along. And I think my last slide also has this information, so if you want to take a nap now, you can sort of skip the middle part of this. This is from the 2014 American College of Cardiology, American Heart Association guideline. It sounds dated because it's now 10 years old, and I would say it is somewhat dated, but it is actually the most recent one. But there's good news. They're in the process of revising the guideline. It's due out. It was actually due to be published in February of this year, but there's been a little bit of a delay. So I think they're now saying it's shooting for something like June. Usually these are updated about every 5 years or so, but because of COVID, I think everything was quite set back. So please look forward to that new publication. And again, if you want to include a request in your email to me, I would be happy to send you that publication when the new one comes out as well. But what I really liked about this 111-page, I believe, article, which has a lot of information in it, is this particular statement. This probably is my favorite statement from there, because I think it really emphasizes that, you know, we are very concerned about ischemic heart disease, right? We're very concerned about patients with coronary artery disease. And we do know that patients that suffer complications after anesthesia and surgery, the number one most significant risk is cardiovascular, and the number one and number two, along with pulmonary complications, are cardiac complications. But I think that we need to be less concerned moving forward with those patients with ischemic disease and more concerned about those with either heart failure or atrial fibrillation or, frankly, valvular disease as well. And I think that's because we've learned how to take really good care of patients with ischemic heart disease, both anesthesia providers as well as cardiologists. And I think medical management and anesthesia techniques very frequently protect many, many patients from ischemic events. And then if they do have ischemic events, I think we have much better rescue methods for those patients. So we can save their lives. We can save myocardium by taking them to interventional procedures. But I think patients with heart failure and with atrial fibrillation tend to do much worse in the perioperative period compared to those with ischemic disease. They're a rising population. In fact, heart failure in the United States is the number one cause of a hospitalization in our Medicare population, which is those patients 65 and over. And you can see here, a patient with heart failure carries about a 3 times higher risk as somebody with just ischemic heart disease. And a patient with atrial fibrillation carries about 2 times the risk. And many times, I think that we, again, what we do intraoperatively actually hurts patients with heart failure and hurts patients with atrial fibrillation, where typically in the intraoperative period, the anesthesia, at least, tends to protect patients with ischemic heart disease. And that's why we typically see patients getting into problems with ischemic heart disease in the postoperative period, not actually intraoperatively. But our fluid management, the cardiac depressant drugs that we use for anesthesia, and the stress responses, and the proarrhythmogenic drugs we use, the vasoactive substances we use, are all increase the risk of patients with both heart failure and atrial fibrillation. The other thing about heart failure and atrial fibrillation is they all kind of go together. And in fact, ischemic heart disease is a major risk factor for developing heart failure and atrial fibrillation. Age is an increasing risk factor, as well as other things I'm going to cover briefly. This is going to be a very brief highlight because I only have 15 minutes to do this. But we're talking about risk prediction tools. And I think that this is a guideline or taken directly from the ACCHA guideline. And they suggest that the best way to assess a patient's risk is by using a validated risk assessment tool. I believe there's 3 basic risk assessment tools for non-cardiac surgery. There's a couple other risk assessment tools that you can use for more specialized surgery, for example, maybe vascular surgery. But for general non-cardiac surgery, you have the RCRI, which is the oldest one on this list. And then you have what we call MICA, or also known as Gupta. And then you have the American College of Surgeons NISQIP calculator. The first two, RCRI and MICA, only look at risk associated with cardiovascular or predicting cardiovascular events, where the ACS NISQIP calculator actually looks at a more global risk assessment, including discharge to skilled nursing facilities, surgical site infections, and things, risks other than cardiovascular. But the other important thing is that these risk calculators consider both the surgery and the patient together. So you don't use a risk calculator and say it's a low-risk patient for a low-risk surgery, or it's a low-risk patient for a high-risk surgery. You say that the overall perioperative risk is low or elevated. The American College of Surgeons, the American College of Cardiology, decided to drop really the low, intermediate, and high risk categories, which used to correspond with less than 1%, 1 to 5%, and greater than 5% risk. And instead now they prefer using a low risk, which is less than 1% perioperative cardiovascular risk, or elevated risk, which is anything above 1%. So this is some examples. Gupta, I think there's about 11 different questions that you have to answer for this. It includes a lot of the same risk things that are in the RCRI. You can go online and fill this out. It's free of charge. You get a percentage. So it will give you a 1, 2, or et cetera percentage. There's a picture of the American College of Surgeons, NISQIP. It's also free of charge online. You just have to accept their guide, their sort of criteria. This is the most specific one in a couple ways. One is you can put in a very specific surgery. The Gupta or MICA gives you just, I think, it used to be 5 different categories of surgeries. Now I think they're up to 9 or 11, but it's still things like major orthopedics or gynecologic surgery, where with the American College of Surgeons, you can actually put in a hysterectomy with a BSO and a lymph node dissection, they include a lot of non-invasive or minimally invasive surgeries as well, where the other calculators, the RCRI and the MICA, tend to be just open procedures. They don't differentiate between laparoscopic or open, where the American College of Surgeons does. And I'm going to cover that a little bit about how one looks at the risk of surgery. So I personally like using the American College of Surgeons, but it does require you to go to their database and use it. It takes a little bit more time. You do not need to know any specific lab values, so you don't need to know the hemoglobin. You don't need to know the creatinine level. Everything is based on history. For example, history of diabetes or history of heart failure. And then you hit calculate and you get it. RCRI is probably the most widely used. It's the one that's most sort of intuitive that you can just remember it. It's just these five different categories, and each one counts for 1 point. And then depending on the amount, typically depends on which sort of the original data show that you had to have two or more of these to be above 1%. There was one study out of Canada a couple years ago by Emmanuel Duceppe that showed that even if you had zero RCRI risk predictors, you still had a risk that was about 3.5%. Problem with that study was is they only looked at very high-risk surgeries or relatively high-risk surgeries in a relatively large or higher-risk population. So I think we still should be using the original, which is you have to have two or more to be into the percentage, where at least with the NISQIP and the Gupta, they give you a percentage right off the bat. You don't have to do that conversion. So this is a study I did a few years ago looking at the risk of surgeries because, frankly, I don't believe there's been any other study to date or no study before that that actually objectively looked at the risk of surgery. And many different bodies, such as the American College of Cardiology, defines risk differently than the American College of Surgeons. And when you think about it, when you look at the risk of surgery, there could be a bleeding risk. There could be a thrombotic risk. There'd be a cardiovascular risk. So it's really not a good idea to think of risk of surgery as this global risk. So what we did was we looked at patients in the database, the actual American College of Surgeons database at the time we did the study. We looked at every 65-year-old diabetic woman that had ever had surgery that was put into the database. This is really actual patients. We looked at a 65-year-old female with diabetes because we wanted to select out a standard patient, and we looked to see what the risk was. And at this time, again, because they were still categorized into low, intermediate, and high risk, for example, a lumpectomy, which is also known as a partial mastectomy, carries about half the risk as a simple mastectomy. They would both be considered low-risk procedures, but actually, mastectomy carries about twice the risk. But if you do a free flap reconstruction for that patient, a plastic surgery for that patient, you've now escalated that procedure into a high risk category. So I think that it's really interesting that just these simple nuances of changes, and that's why using something very globally and saying like orthopedic surgery or major orthopedic surgery means very little. We also, I don't know how many people, you know, have lived through the era of surgeons learning how to do laparoscopic surgeries or learning how to do robotic surgeries. But, you know, typically early on, it took them much longer to do a laparoscopic appendectomy, for example, than it did an open appendectomy. And I used to think, why didn't we make just one little incision that this big and take out this appendix rather than put three incisions around the patient and take twice as long? But after I did this study and I showed that not just with lap and open appies, but with almost every laparoscopic procedure that we looked at, the risk was about half of that of an open procedure. So I think if we can get the patient through a laparoscopic procedure, you're going to reduce the cardiovascular risk. So let's talk a little bit about heart failure. We know that heart failure is a major risk factor for patients having major surgeries, but I was really intrigued by this study that looked at low-risk surgeries. These were all ambulatory surgeries. It was almost 20,000 patients, the VA database. And you can see that the mortality risk was significantly higher in those who had heart failure. Systolic heart failure carries a greater risk than diastolic heart failure, but diastolic heart failure carries a higher risk than patients with no heart failure. And this confirmed what we've known from other studies with major surgeries, that decompensated heart failure carries the highest risk. So it's not that I think, again, we can't just look at the patient risk. We have to look at the surgical risk. But ironically, all of the calculators that I'm talking about have never included the anaesthesia risk. It's a little puzzling to me, but we do appear to show that a well-conducted general anesthetic for most patients carries the same risk as a regional or a MAC or monitored anesthesia care or sedation. In fact, in some studies, MAC or sedation carries a higher risk than actually general anesthesia. So what about atrial fibrillation? I mentioned about how it increases with age. Other risk factors include hypertension, diabetes, hyperthyroidism, obstructive sleep apnea, and ischemic heart disease. I think the overall principal goals is that, you know, both preoperatively and postoperatively, you should ensure good hemodynamic stability and optimal anticoagulation perioperatively. So that's usually the things that you have to really focus on. There's not strong evidence that rhythm control is better than rate control in the short term. Long-term rhythm control definitely has advantages over simply rate control. But in the short term, if you've got a patient with atrial fibrillation, you really consider that there's very little benefit likely in getting that patient converted to sinus rhythm before you proceed with surgery. For their long-term management, yes, but not for long-term. And this is a quote directly from the ACCHA guidelines, that stable patients with atrial fib do not require evaluation in the perioperative period or modification of medications other than anticoagulant adjustments. Typically, we do continue all of those medications. So what about if you've got a patient who you newly discovered preoperative atrial fibrillation, either the day of surgery or before, right before that? Again, I think you would evaluate that patient and look at the risks of the surgery. Low-risk surgeries probably carry much more minimal risk in a patient with atrial fib than bigger surgeries. It is important to remember that the risk of thromboembolic phenomenon or stroke is the highest within 30 days of cardioversion. So therefore, if you've got a patient who needs time-sensitive or urgent surgery, you're better off taking them to the OR with rate control, not trying to cardiovert them ahead of time, because it typically is recommended that anticoagulation be continued for 30 days after pharmacologic or electrical cardioversion. Even pharmacologic cardioversion carries a high risk. However, if you do have a patient who has new onset atrial fibrillation and you proceed with the surgery and they have not been evaluated, it is very important that you make sure that patient gets follow-up post-op, because there's also increasing evidence in the 30 days of the initial diagnosis of atrial fibrillation carries a very high risk of stroke as well. This is another group of patients you have to worry about. And again, as we have patients living longer with heart failure and ischemic heart disease, you're going to see more of these kinds of devices, both pacemakers and ICDs. So I'm happy to say that the new ACCHA guideline that's coming out has a very robust section on CIEDs, because the other two documents that are there that are available are from 2011, the heart rhythm document, and the American Society of Anesthesiologists, which is also somewhat dated, from 2020, because these devices change very rapidly. I think it's also important to remember that these patients have sick hearts, especially the ones with ICDs, because sometimes we get so fixated on the device and we're so worried about managing the device that we forget to make sure we evaluate the underlying heart disease. I used to always talk about magnets and say magnets, 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 that was the way to go, but now I don't say that anymore. These devices can be very, very complicated. But for most patients who have a pacemaker, most patients with pacemakers, a magnet will force pacing. The exception seems to be with Biotronic devices, which have very unique magnet responses. For most patients with ICDs, the magnet will inhibit or prevent tachyarrhythmia treatments, so the patient will not be cardioverted, for example. But in patients who have an ICD that are pacemaker dependent, you must always reprogram those devices, because a magnet can only do one thing. It forces a pacer to pace, or it turns off the tachytherapy in patients with ICDs. So again, I used to be a big proponent for just have a magnet, not anymore. This is just briefly on valvular disease. I think don't forget to still listen to the patient's heart. As patients live longer, the same risk factors that cause ischemic heart disease cause aortic stenosis, and we have a lot of patients with undiagnosed murmurs who turn out to have severe and critical aortic stenosis. So the ACCHA guideline recommends that any patient over the age of 50, any patient who has symptoms compatible with cardiovascular disease, or anyone with an abnormal ECG who has an undiagnosed murmur needs an echocardiogram. And it's not, we used to think that a lot of patients with critical and severe aortic stenosis needed to have their valves replaced before they had non-cardiac surgery. We've pulled back a lot from that. It doesn't necessarily mean they need their valve replaced, but you're simply knowing the type of valve your disease. Is it regurgitant, which is usually tolerated much better than stenotic disease? Is it the mitral valve? Is it the aortic valve? What does the left ventricle look like? What does the right ventricle look like? Can help you much, much better take care of these patients. So knowledge is power here. Remember, I mentioned a little bit about stroke. I just want to remind you that strokes and ischemic heart disease go hand in hand. Strokes and atrial fibrillation go hand in hand, and strokes and valvular disease go hand in hand. So the American College of Cardiology does recommend delaying non-cardiac surgery for 6 months after a stroke, and a history of cerebrovascular disease is a strong predictor of both recurrent or perioperative stroke and post-op MIs. And we see increasing numbers of strokes in the perioperative period, and many of them are silent strokes. So in summary, please look out for this document, the 2024 ACCHA guideline that's due to be published very soon. Please contact me if I can help with that, obtaining any information for you. And now I think, Dr. Berry, you're up next.
Thank you, Dr. Schweitzer. I'm going to drift a little bit away from specifically the cardiac assessment. Dr. Schweitzer already made a very brief and very, very good approach to that. I have no conflict of interest. For this session, I did a survey among Latin American colleagues. We got 115 responses. Around 65% were from Colombia and Mexico, and the rest from other countries in Latin America. So the first question I asked was, when we thought about risk, what were they thinking of? Because it would seem straightforward that we are thinking about cardiac risk, or is it global risk, or what? In this scenario, we can see that among this cohort of Latin American colleagues, 70% thought about risk, about global risk, not specifically cardiac, not a specific anesthetic, but global risk. 37% thought about anesthetic risk, 17% about surgical risk, and 17% about medical complications. So there's a lot of risk scores. So we have the ASA, which is clearly not a risk score, but it's universally used as a risk score. Actually, in 1941, the author said that it was not a risk score, and it was basically used for statistical data in anesthesia. Then the Goldman came in the 70s, then the Detsky in the 80s, then the RCRI in 99, then the ACCHAA guidelines, which are to be updated, in which I must point something very interesting. These are the American College of Cardiology, American Heart Association guidelines, and they are the task force was led by an anesthesiologist, Dr. Lee Fleischer. That's a very important point I want to make about it. Then there's the Gupta or the MICA, which was published based on the NESQIP database, and these are more recent, the Canadian ones, which are basically based on the results of the McMaster group that has done a lot of trials. And it includes also some authors who are anesthesiologists. And the most recent ones are the European ones. One of the problems around all these guidelines and all these scores and all these things is that if you see the literature, there's no clear-cut evidence that if you use this score or this guideline, you will have better outcomes. There's no such thing. In fact, most of these guidelines have extremely erratic adherence to their use. So I asked also in this survey, how did they use these scores? So 92% use the ASA. Oddly enough, 34% use the Goldman, which is completely anachronic. That's nothing to do with current day practice. The NESQIP was used by almost one-third, the RCRI, and et cetera, and the other last two are the English ones, the POSSUM and the SORT. And one of the important things is, when is this assessed? In many countries, the preoperative assessment by anesthesia is not very common. In Latin America, it is gradually in more countries more common. In Colombia, it's mandatory. We perform pre-op assessment in 100% of all the patients. And so we had around 97% had pre-operative assessment, medical consultations 14, the risk board and the pre-op room. So that's when the assessment, the risk assessment is done. Take in mind that if you calculate the risks of a patient just before he's going into the OR, there's very little that you can do to optimize or to intervene with this patient. And how to use information. Interestingly enough, 20% of the colleagues used to overestimate the risk because of medical legal concerns. So once you do the risk assessment, what do you want to do with it? And that's, I think, it's key. Because what's the point of knowing that you have a MICA of 1.3% of risk of having an MI in the post-op? Or if you have a 2.7, what's a big deal? I mean, is that a difference when you tell the patient you have a 1.3 risk or 2.7? So what? Is that anything that you'll change for that? So there's different options whenever you find something different from baseline risk, which is you might postpone for additional workup, or you can enhance monitoring or care. You can modify the procedure or define high dependency unit or ICU care in the post-op. One paper by Dr. Vijay Sundera Duminda in Canada, analyzing 192,000 consults, show that medical consults worsened the likelihood of outcomes in patients. It was worsened the patients, increased the length of stay, increased the costs. So is it useful to delay a procedure to send them for medical consults to fix something? It doesn't seem so. And this other paper in the US with almost 14,000 patients shows that you would expect that if somebody gets a medical consult, it's because he's sicker. When he did this, he realized that, no, it didn't. It's just completely erratic. Likewise, what if in Latin America, actually, in Colombia, but in Latin America, many colleagues think that a patient should be determined whether they have CAD or not, coronary artery disease. And so they should be sent to cardiac consult, because if they have CAD, they should probably get their hearts fixed. They should get a CABG or they should get a PCCA. But this trial, almost 20 years old, in high-risk procedures, vascular surgery, in patients who were selected with abnormal coronary artery tests, they randomized them, half of them with medical therapy, and the one half of them CABGs or PTCAs. No difference in high-risk vascular surgery. So sending the patients for cardiac consult doesn't seem to work either, even in high-risk cases, except if the patient requires intervention because of their symptoms, independent of whether he's going to get surgery or not. And more recently, using the Canadian recommendations, this paper published last year showed that among 24,000 patients in which they used the criteria to determine whether or not to measure troponins in the post-op, they found out that using the updated recommendations by the Canadian Cardiovascular Society did not change the rate of MI detection. So you get to a point where you see that these guidelines or the usual approaches might not yield better outcomes for our patients. So in our place, we, like I mentioned, in Colombia, we have mandatory preoperative assessment. In our hospital, we basically, it's a hospital that's a large HMO, and we carry a high-risk committee. And in this high-risk committee, from all these risk scores, this is the one I want to point out, the NESQIP. Why? Because you can calculate, like Dr. Schweitzer mentioned, all kinds of stuff. You get the procedure, you get the medical history, and then you can calculate the risk, the likelihood of anything happening. However, like what I mentioned, for the patient, it seems irrelevant if you are told you have a 3.3% of post-op pneumonia or you have a 6.7% risk of post-op pneumonia. For the patient is, I mean, so what does that gives, I mean, ends up going for me. What I find extremely useful in this high-risk committees where when we get patients, anybody in any stakeholder in the care of the patient is able to send the patients to this committee. When we do this, then this is the one I'm interested in, the discharge to nursing facility. You probably heard in several of the lectures in the conference and in many conferences that the patient's choice or the patient's impact, personal impact, is one of the key issues to address when taking care of them. So if you tell a patient that is an elderly patient is going to be subject to a major procedure, esophageal procedure, and he's told that the likelihood of him never coming back home but going to a nursing facility is 50%, makes the patient and the family think about it. So we use this in order to discuss, because in this committee, we include the surgeon. So we tell him the patient is considering not to get the procedure. So we should think the possibility of modifying the procedure to a much less invasive procedure because the patient is concerned that his life will change dramatically after the procedure. The other aspect to know is there's a huge experience of perioperative outcomes in the UK, which is called the NCPOT, the National Confidential Inquiry of Perioperative Deaths. They made 6 or 7 reports, the last one about 10 years ago. And in this, they analyze the deaths and the complications of major procedures in the NHS. In lots of hospitals, they have audits of all these, and then they analyze and they decide, they confer, and they conclude that A, B, C stuff. One of the things that they concluded in the last one was that many of the patients that had major complications had no pre-op assessments. Nobody really assessed the risk. And so that is important. And they realized that they have a 30-day mortality, which is the preoperative mortality, and we are involved in that, 7 times as much if they did not have any pre-op assessment. So when this should be this be done? Should it be allowed? I mean, it should be delegated to the surgeon to do it, or consults ordered by the surgeon, or should we do it? Like I said, the experience in Latin America is that we do it. And when should it be done? We, in our system, we tell, I mean, it's white wine for surgeons that if they think that the patient is a little unusual, different from usual, they should send it over so that we can address whatever. For example, patient blood management. We started in our hospital patient blood management in 2016. And we see the patient in the pre-op clinic, in the pre-anesthetic clinic, and there we identify the patient needs anemia correction. So we order the iron, and we call the surgeon, doctor or whatever. I think that you should reschedule your patient for 3 or 4 weeks because until the iron starts working. For example, that's one intervention. So the patient needs to be assessed with time before. And there's the last thing I want to point out about risk, which I think it's the key. This is a paper among many, but it's not the only one, analyzing 85,000 surgeries in the U.S. And they compared high quality hospitals to poor quality hospitals. And they found out that poor quality hospitals and high quality hospitals had the same rate of complications. Shocking. The difference was that the high outcome hospitals rescued their patients quickly, whereas the low quality hospitals delayed. And so the issue is that we have to address the likelihood of failure to rescue. And in myocardial, which is the topic of this module, it is much more clear. 20% of the patients with MIs had failure to rescue scenarios in this cohort. So what should be the purpose of assessing risk? To define, in Latin America, our wards are the Wild West. So they are basically abandoned to their luck, to their whatever. So the only way which we can identify patients who are having complications is to enhance their observation. So they should go to high dependency units or to the ICU so that we can quickly identify deviation from normal behavior and avoid failure to rescue. So when asking people in our survey, we found out that nicely, you know, 2/3 of the colleagues used this risk to determine the request post-op follow-up. So in our hospital, finally, what would we do? We consider, like always, like everywhere, the surgery, magnitude of the surgery, the comorbidities, and we include a third aspect that usually, I've never seen it actually explicitly described in literature, the preoperative team. It's completely different if you take a patient for a TAVI in the Cleveland Clinic or you take it into a local hospital who is a crazy guy doing TAVIs. It's completely different. So you have to take into consideration the preoperative team, have local information, have results of your outcomes, analyze the local experience. In our hospital, we do, in the States it's common, but in our hospital we do 500 hip arthroplasties in the day care setting. In hospitals close by, 5 or 10% of the patients go to the ICU. So it's completely different, absolutely different. We do bariatric surgery in a 23-hour mode. So, and we have 9,000 of those. But that's not the same for hospitals just across the street. So the local experience is extremely important. In our case, since we have a close relationship with the McMaster Group, this is PJ Devereaux, we were the first to randomize patients in the POI study in Latin America. We basically follow the recommendations of the Canadian Cardiovascular Society, and with this, we send the patients to the HDU or ICU in order to be assessed to be followed up and avoid failure to rescue. So the goal, in my perception, of risk assessment is to improve perioperative, postoperative vigilance. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'm a little bit surprised to see such a huge audience so early in the morning. Thank you for the warm introduction. It's a privilege to be here today. My name is Shoichi Uezono. I'm from Tokyo, Japan. I'm going to try to make my presentation short and sweet. Okay. All right. So over the next 15 minutes or so, I'm going to explore how the contribution of functional capacity assessment in cardiac risk assessment has developed in the last decade. We will delve into key historical milestones, the challenges along with the way, and speculate on what the future might hold in this vital field. So let's start defining what you mean by functional capacity in the context of preoperative cardiac risk assessment. It's the patient's capability to engage in physical tasks that rely on aerobic metabolism, essentially a metric of heart's efficiency in delivering oxygen to muscle during physical exertion. So this is quantified in metabolic equivalents, or METs, which approximate the maximum oxygen consumption during the activity. For example, climbing two flights of stairs nonstop equates to 4 METs, and this level is often used as a threshold to indicate poor functional capacity. The current SEC-AHA guideline underscore the need for need to assess functional capacity primarily for risk stratification before surgery. A patient with a functional capacity of moderate to good may proceed surgery, directory surgery without additional cardiac tests. This is based on studies linking poor functional capacity with higher rates of post-operative cardiac events. It's worth noting that the cutoff value for poor functional capacity is set at 4 METs. Even though there is not direct evidence supporting this threshold. 3 years following the US guidelines, the Canadian Cardiovascular Society issued their own, diverging in their approach to functional capacity. They refrained from endorsing patient self-reported functional capacity for cardiac risk estimation, citing insufficient evidence. This sparked a debate on the reliability of self-assessment and the need for more reliable measurement methods. Functional capacity assessment comes into two forms, subjective and objective. Subjectively, we might ask, can you climb two flights of stairs without resting? So this method is straightforward, but varies based on the questions asked and the patient's self-awareness. This could lead to inaccuracies in assessing METs. Objectively, we can use standardized tools like the Duke Activity Status Index, or DASI, which is a validated questionnaire aligning well with objectively measured functional capacity. Cardiopulmonary exercise testing, or CPET, is a gold standard for objective evaluation, but it's time-consuming and costly, so it's not common in routine assessment. The first two measurements are self-reported assessments of functional capacity in the literature. So many anesthesiologists now utilize the DASI questionnaire for functional capacity evaluation. The DASI is a series of 12 questions that assess a patient's ability to perform daily activities at varying intensities. Answers are simply yes or no, with each carrying a specific weight. The cumulative score provides an estimate of the functional capacity, where a higher score represents greater capacity. Studies have shown that DASI may predict post-operative cardiac complications more effectively than subjective assessment. The debate over preoperative functional or capacity assessment calls for a direct comparison between subjective and objective assessments. A landmark investigation in this discourse was the MET study featured in The Lancet in 2018. This March Center international cohort study surveyed approximately 1,400 high-risk patients slated for major noncardiac surgery. the med store, our med study critically addressed whether anesthesiologists' subjective functional capacity assessment could predict postoperative cardiac complications. Seeking alternatives, the study compared subjective assessment with the DASI score, peak oxygen consumption from CPET, and serum B-type natriuretic peptides levels. The main focus was on death or myocardial infarction within 30 days post-surgery, among other outcomes. Okay. So the MET study concluded that subjective functional capacity assessment did not correlate with the primary outcomes, failing to predict cardiac complications. However, the DASI score did enhance the prediction of myocardial injury or death within 30 days post-surgery, questioning the current reliance on subjective assessment. So in light of the limitations of self-reported functional capacity, the European Society of Cardiologists updated guidelines still endorse it for risk assessment in select patient populations. This may raise questions about the continued reliance on subjective assessment. It seems that the European guidelines preference for self-reported functional capacity may be informed by research, including this study in Switzerland, with approximately 4,500 high-risk patients undergoing a major non-cardiac surgery. This study could provide insights into the practicality and reliability of self-assessment in a clinical setting. During their preoperative assessment, the patients were simply asked about their ability to climb two flights of stairs. This single question aimed to evaluate the functional capacity of patients who were considered to be at a relatively higher risk than those with the METS studies, which I previously mentioned. So this is a Kaplan-Meier curve for major adverse cardiac events or MACE in the y-axis versus days after surgery in the x-axis. Those unable to climb two flights of stairs, indicated by the blue dotted line, demonstrate a higher incidence of MACE compared to those who can. The study concluded that self-reported ability to climb fewer than two flights is an independent risk factor for MACE, both 30 days and a year after surgery. Adding this self-reported metric to the revised cardiac risk index enhanced its predictable accuracy, supporting its use in the 2022 European guidelines. The debate over subjective versus objective assessments in preoperative evaluation persists. A study recently published in the British Journal of Anesthesia explored the added value of self-reported functional capacity to existing risk prediction models. This comprehensive international research spanned 150 centers across 25 countries involving around 15,000 patients scheduled for high-risk non-cardiac surgeries. In the study, researchers employed the MET repair questionnaire, a structural tool designed to evaluate self-reported functional capacity. It assessed four different aspects: MET as estimated by the questionnaire, The number of floors a patient can climb, the patient's own assessment of their cardiopulmonary fitness, and their level of regular physical activity. The study indicated that self-reported functional capacity assessment did not enhance the predictive value over existing clinical risk factors. This finding suggests a cautious approach to relying on self-reported functional capacity for critical preoperative cardiac risk decisions. So to conclude, these are what I would like to submit to you today. Having a preoperative assessment of one's functional capacity is essential for before any surgery. However, choosing the right assessment method is crucial. The DAS questionnaire is a strong recommendation due to its objectivity. Despite some ambiguity around the DAS score cutoff value, it remains a viable method. Additionally, integrating objective measures like NT-proBNP could greatly refine cardiac risk accuracy. Also, the potential for AI to overhaul preoperative evaluations, including cardiac risk assessment, is promising. So we should finally stay updated with the imminent U.S. guideline revisions. Well, thank you very much for your attention, and I look forward to your questions and answers.
For those who have a little chance to stay, I think we're going to see if we have any questions. So maybe this is loading. So, I agree with you about the what do we do with risk assessment, right? Because I think that we used to clear patients for surgery, right, or cardiologists and, you know, other physicians would clear patients. And we kind of got rid of that concept because, you know, we can't really clear patients or not clear them. But I think it's kind of evolved to this risk assessment. But if you don't do something about their risk assessment. So can you maybe leave the audience with a couple of pearls of advice of when they do have a high-risk patient for any particular condition that they can do something about it?
Probably one of the most important new aspects that the Canadian Cardiovascular Society guidelines introduced based on the research by the McMaster group of P.J. Devereaux is the issue of NT-proBNP. Okay. This is extremely useful, in particular to what Dr. Schweitzer mentioned. Probably today we know for a fact that patients with congestive heart failure are the patients that have the highest perioperative risk. And using the NT-proBNP in pre-op to identify these patients, because as you know, there's a normal ejection fraction congestive heart failure, and there's low ejection fraction congestive heart failure. So the normal fraction congestive heart failure, our patients are a little difficult to identify. So using these NT-proBNP assay before surgery, before in the assessment, can identify those patients and tell us that the patient is at significant risk, because the risk is much higher than having CAD. So those patients should be particularly monitored in the post-op in an HDU or an ICU. So that I think that's one of the important issues. And overall, I mentioned if you find somebody with a risk which seems clearly out of the regular, the threshold of trying to have the patient in an area where he is better monitored is ideal. Nowadays, we've seen the technology of all these wearable devices in which you can have continuous monitoring, those things. If you don't have those, consider the possibility of sending these patients to the HDU.
Thank you. So, Jana, we have a question here. Would self-reporting be more accurate if we ask about activities that make patients hot and puffed, or I guess have symptomatology, as opposed to can you just do something, but what kind of symptoms do you get when you do something?
Oh, you mean symptoms?
Yes. If, should we ask patients about symptomatology that they get or symptoms that they get when they do a particular activity? Would that be perhaps better at identifying those at-risk patients?
Well, you might be right. I have no idea to answer that kind of questions. You have any idea?
Well, I think, you know, when we put patients on stress tests, a treadmill, right, for stress testing, we ask, you know, are you having symptoms? Or one of the markers to stop a stress test or consider positive is the classic symptoms of chest pain or shortness of breath. So I do think that, you know, we lose that by not asking patients if they actually. And I think the other thing about risk assessment is that it asks a patient the last time they did something. So don't say to them, can you walk up a flight of stairs? Or can you walk up two flights of stairs? But when did you actually last walk up two flights of stairs? Because I think most patients overestimate what they can do or they think they can do. I also think it's important to make sure that you're talking about the same flight of stairs. So a flight of stairs is actually defined as 11 steps. Some flights have 4 or 7, but a full flight of stairs is 11 steps. And the other thing is how quickly do they walk up those flight of stairs? You know, if they're taking 1 or 2 steps and then they're huffing and puffing and hanging onto the handrail, and it takes them 10 minutes to walk up the flight of stairs, that's, I think, very different than I just start and I walk all the way to the top. And I think that's the difference between the DASI score and this flight of stairs, right? Because it says, you know, at certain activities, like can you rake leaves? And if patients don't rake leaves, they usually say, no, I don't rake leaves. But we ask them, can you walk up a flight of stairs? Not, do you walk up a flight of stairs?
One practical approach that I personally use is I simply tell the patient, take the elevator down and please climb the flights. The flight of stairs, and we'll meet back again. And I check him up. So there you can identify the symptoms and the real deal that he's really climbed the flight of stairs. And in the questioning the symptoms, you have the usual angina symptoms and the angina equivalents. So if a patient's usual activity is changed, you have to start thinking about that being an angina equivalent symptom. Okay, his functional class has changed recently, or it has unusual symptoms with the activity. Those are angina equivalent symptoms that require further assessment.
So it's a kind of art, right? It's a kind of art for our side, anesthesiologist, to ask for, to estimate like a patient's cardiac risk, right? We really need to acquire the skills to question to the patients.
Yes, take a good history. So those of you who want to go up back and set up a preoperative clinic, if you don't have one, put it on the second floor and and really close to a flight of stairs and make sure the elevators don't work because your patients can make it up to the second floor. So someone's asking about DASI score. Is there a DASI score that they should be concerned about and trigger investigation for further evaluation?
Well, if you look at the DAS questionnaire for each question, some questions are very tricky to answer, like gardening or like sexual activity or something like that. So some people may not easily answer that kind of questions.
I think that typically a DASI score of 34, as I recall, is considered the equivalent of a MET of 4. So if it's below 34, then that would be considered the equivalent to the below a met of 4. And typically, if it's 34 and above, then it would be the equivalent of being able to proceed to surgery without further testing.
In my institution, I take like a 25 or 24, to be honest with you.
Interesting. Yeah. Yes, yes. Well, that would be probably more like a 3, I believe. So I think they're asking about, is there a NT-BNP, a particular group of patients that we should be targeting to do that test in? Or is it everybody having any kind of surgery, we should be doing an NT-proBNP?
The guidelines that the Canadians have devised includes either major surgery that consider that gradually in North America, the patients who get hospitalized are basically major surgeries, who are 65 or above, or younger if they have the two RCRI criteria. You have CHF, or they have a stroke, or they have diabetes, or they have an MI, or you have a valvular disease. So all of those things, if you add up 2 points and you are under 65 and you are having a hospitalized procedure, you will get NT-proBNP. And the idea around that is that you can follow the trend. If a patient has a very high NT-proBNP, it is probably reasonable to delay the procedure and optimize the conditions of the patient. Because if the patient has high NT-proBNP pre-op, the likelihood of having complications because they are having CHF is very significant, much higher than coronary artery disease. So we used to be afraid of having patients with coronary artery disease that might be a little unstable. We should really be much more concerned about CHF, like Dr. Schweitzer mentioned.
I think we have to wrap up here. So we really appreciate you guys coming to our panel. Thank you very much. We'll be in the back in just a moment, and if there's some more questions, we'd be happy to take a few of those.